In this video, you're going to study about the pons. The pons is the middle part of the brainstem and it is situated between the midbrain and the medulla. It lies in the posterior cranial fossa on the clivus anterior to the cerebellum. On either side, the pons is continuous as the middle cerebellar peduncle, thus forming a bridge between the two cerebellar hemisphere. The pons is about 2.5 centimeters long and forms the upper half of the floor of the fourth ventricle. Structurally, the pons consist of gray and white matter containing the number of nuclei and the fiber tract respectively. Next, we'll see about the external features. The pons has two surfaces. So this is the ventral surface of the pons and this is the dorsal surface of the pons. It has two borders, a superior border and an inferior border. So now we'll see about the ventral surface or anterior surface. It is convex in both directions, from before backwards and side to side. It is transversely striated due to the underlying pontocerebellar fibers. In the median plane, it presents a vertical groove. So this is a vertical groove that is known as the basilar groove, which lodges the basilar artery. The trigeminal nerve is attached to this surface by two roots, a small motor root and a large sensory root. The motor root is medial to the sensory root. A vertical line drawn just lateral to the sensory root demarcates the junction between the pons and the middle cerebellar peduncle. Rostrally, the junction between the midbrain and the pons is marked by the cerebral peduncles. So these are the cerebral peduncles disappearing into the upper part of the pons. Caudally, the pontomedullary junction is marked by a shallow groove, and in this groove, from medial to lateral, you get the abducens nerve, the sixth cranial nerve, then the facial nerve and the nervous intermedius. And then you have the vestibulocochlear nerve. So from medial to lateral, these nerve emerges. Next, we'll see about the dorsal or the posterior surface. The dorsal surface of the pons is covered by the cerebellum and separated from it by the cavity of fourth ventricle. The dorsal surface of the pons is triangular in shape and forms the upper part of the floor of the fourth ventricle. We'll see the features in detail in the fourth ventricle. Next, we'll see about the superior border. The cerebral peduncles are attached to the superior border and the superior cerebellar artery curve along this border, intervening between the oculomotor nerve and the trochlear nerve. Then we'll see about the inferior border. The upper end of the medulla is continuous with this border. The anterior inferior cerebellar artery, so this is the anterior inferior cerebellar artery, curves around the inferior border. Next, we'll see about the internal structure. A cross section at any level of the pons shows two distinct regions. A large ventral part, which is known as the basilar part. And you get a dorsal part, which is known as the tegmental part. The ventral or the basilar part is continuous inferiorly with the pyramid of the medulla on each side with the middle cerebellar peduncle. The dorsal or the tegmental part is a direct upward continuation of the medulla excluding the pyramid. The structure of the basilar part is basically the same at all levels of the pons, but the structure of the tegmental part vary considerably in the upper and the lower part of the pons. So now we'll see about the features of the basilar part. This part is composed of longitudinal bundles of fibers, and you have the transverse fibers, and then you get the pontine nuclei. The longitudinal bundles of the fibers include the corticopontine, the corticonuclear, and the corticospinal fibers. The corticopontine fibers relay in the ipsilateral pontine nuclei. The corticonuclear fibers terminate in the contralateral motor nuclei of the cranial nerves. The corticospinal fibers converge towards the lower part of the pons and forms the pyramid in the medulla. The transverse fibers arise in the pontine nuclei and they cross to the opposite side to form the middle cerebellar peduncle, and these are pontocerebellar fibers. The pontine nuclei are scattered among the longitudinal and the transverse fibers. The pontine nuclei form an important part of corticopontocerebellar pathway, which connects the cerebral cortex of one side to the cerebellar hemisphere of the opposite side. During development, some of the pontine nuclei get displaced and they form the arcuate nucleus and the pontobulbar body. The features of the tegmentum differs at two levels. First, we'll study about the transverse section through the lower pons. The transverse section through the lower caudal part of the pons passes through the facial colliculus. So the features are, first we'll see about the gray matter. The gray matter at this level comprises of the abducens nerve nucleus, then you have the facial nerve nucleus, then you have the vestibular cochlear nucleus, and then you get the spinal nucleus of the trigeminal nerve. The abducens nerve nucleus lies beneath the facial colliculus in the floor of the fourth ventricle, just lateral to the medial longitudinal bundle. So this is the medial longitudinal bundle. It lies lateral to the medial longitudinal bundle. The motor nucleus of the facial nerve lies ventral lateral to the abducens nerve nucleus. So ventrolateral to the abducens nerve nucleus, you get the motor nucleus of the facial nerve. The fibers of the facial nerve first wind around the abducens nerve nucleus, producing the facial colliculus, then passes anteriorly between the facial nerve nucleus and the nucleus of the spinal tract of the trigeminal nerve. Here you have to know about neurobiotaxis. In early embryogenesis, the motor nucleus of the facial nerve is located dorsolateral to the cranial end of the abducens nerve nucleus. Thereafter, it migrates caudally along the dorsal surface of the nucleus, and then it ventromedial to the abducens nerve nucleus until it reaches the permanent position in close proximity to the spinal nucleus of the trigeminal nerve, a site of maximum sensory stimulus, which establish a quick reflex responses. Such migration of motor nucleus towards the sensory nucleus is known as the neurobiotaxis. Eventually, the motor fibers of the facial nerve undergo a looped course, that is the internal genu of the facial nerve, along the dorsomedial aspect of the abducens nerve nucleus. Then you have the superior salivary nucleus, inferior salivary nucleus and lacrimatory nucleus, which lie medial to the motor nucleus of the facial nerve. And then you have the nucleus of tractus solitarius lies lateral to the superior salivary nucleus. Then you have the vestibular nucleus, which lie beneath the vestibular area in the floor of the fourth ventricle. And then you have the dorsal and the ventral cochlear nerve nuclei, which are situated dorsal and ventral to the inferior cerebellar pedangle respectively. Then you have the spinal nucleus of the trigeminal nerve and its tract, and they are located on the antromedial aspect of the inferior cerebellar pedangle. Next we'll see about the white matter. The white matter at this level comprises of the trapezoid body, then you have the medial lemniscus, then you have the spinal lemniscus, the medial longitudinal bundle, the tectospinal tract, the rubrospinal tract. The trapezoid body is a trapezium shaped mass of white fibers lying in the anterior part of the tegmentum, just posterior to the basilar part of the pons. It is formed by the decussation of transversely running fibers arising from the cochlear nuclei of both sides. The medial lemniscus rotates as it passes from the medulla into the pons, and it is situated in the most anterior part of the tegmentum with its long axis running transversely. So the medial lemniscus rotates in such a way the fibers from the nucleus cuneatus or medial to those from the nucleus gracilis. Somatotopically, it is represented from neck, arm, trunk and leg in medial to lateral sequence. The spinal lemniscus lies lateral to the medial lemniscus and occupies the same peripheral position as in the medulla. Then you get the medial longitudinal bundle, which occupies a paramedian position in the most posterior part. The tectospinal tract are located ventral to the medial longitudinal bundles, and then you have the spinal tract of the trigeminal nerve lies lateral and dorsal to the motor nucleus of the facial nerve. Next we'll see about the transverse section to the upper or the cranial part of the pons. The transverse section through the upper part of the pons passes through the trigeminal nerve nuclei. The tegmentum at this level exhibits a small cavity of fourth ventricle, which is bounded dorsolaterally on either side by the superior cerebellar pedangle and roofed by the superior medullary velum. Next we'll see about the gray matter. The gray matter at this level comprises of the motor and the main sensory nucleus of the trigeminal nerve. So note, the trapezoid body and the nuclei are not seen at this level, and the nuclear component of abducens nerve, facial nerve, vestibular cochlear nerve are missing at this level. The motor nucleus of the trigeminal nerve is situated in the dorsolateral part beneath the lateral part of the fourth ventricle. The emerging motor fibers travel anteriorly through the substance of the pons and exist on the anterior surface. The principal or the main sensory nucleus of the trigeminal nerve is situated lateral to the motor nerve nucleus. Caudally, it is continuous with the nucleus of the spinal tract of the trigeminal nerve, and rostrally, it is continuous with the mesencephalic nucleus of the trigeminal nerve. The nucleus of the locus ceruleus extends from the lower part of the midbrain to this level of the pons. Next, we'll see about the white matter. The white matter at this level consist of the same ascending tract as in the lower part. However, the lateral lemniscus is very well formed here. The spinal lemniscus lies between the medial and the lateral lemniscus. So this is the spinal lemniscus. So here you have four lemnisci from medial to lateral. You have the medial lemniscus, then you have the trigeminal lemniscus, then you have the spinal lemniscus and lateral lemniscus. Thus, the ventral part of the tegmentum immediately posterior to the basilar part presents four lemnisci. So now we'll see about the differences, the structural differences of the tegmentum in the lower pons and the upper pons. In the lower pons, in the gray matter shows the nucleus of the abducens nerve, the facial nerve and the vestibulocochlear nerve. And then you have the nucleus of the spinal tract of the trigeminal nerve. Whereas in the upper pons, it consists of motor and the principal sensory nucleus of the trigeminal nerve and then the caudal part of the nucleus ceruleus. The lower part of the pons, the white matter shows two lemnisci, the medial lemniscus and the spinal lemniscus, and you have the trapezoid body and the nuclei. In the upper part, it consists of four lemniscus, the medial, the trigeminal, the spinal and the lateral. The trapezoid body and the nuclei are absent at this level. Next we'll see about the blood supply. The pons is supplied by numerous pontine branches from the basilar artery. So this is the basilar artery and these are the pontine branches. And by the anterior inferior cerebellar artery. So this also supplies the pons. Next we'll see about the clinical correlation. First we'll study about the Millard-Gabler syndrome or medial inferior pontine syndrome. It results from the lesion in the lower part of the pons, which is so placed that it includes the pyramidal tract and the emerging fibers of the abducens nerve and the facial nerve. The characteristic features of this syndrome are the ipsilateral medial squint due to the involvement of abducens nerve, ipsilateral facial palsy due to the involvement of the facial nerve, and contralateral hemiplegia due to the involvement of the corticospinal tract. The term abducens alternating hemiplegia is sometimes used as there is an ipsilateral medial squint and contralateral hemiplegia. Next we'll see about the pontocerebellar angle syndrome. The anatomical structures located in the pontocerebellar angle include the 7th cranial nerve, the 8th cranial nerve, the flocculus of the cerebellum and the choroid plexus of the 4th ventricle. The pontocerebellar angle syndrome occurs due to the pressure exerted on the lateral region of the caudal part of the pons by acoustic neuroma, a tumor which develops from the Schwann cells surrounding the cochlear nerve near its attachment to the brainstem. The characteristic signs and symptoms are the tinnitus, progressive deafness and vertigo due to the damage of the 8th cranial nerve. Then you have the ipsilateral ataxia and staggering gait due to the compression of the cerebellar peduncle. Then you have the ipsilateral lower motor type of facial palsy due to the involvement of the facial nerve. Then the ipsilateral loss of pain and temperature sensation and loss of corneal reflex due to the involvement of the spinal tract and the nucleus of the trigeminal nerve. Next we'll see about the pontine hemorrhage. The pontine hemorrhage may occur due to the involvement of the branches of the basilar and the anterior inferior cerebellar arteries. If the pontine hemorrhage is extensive and bilateral, the patient presents the following clinical picture. So there will be pinpoint pupil due to the involvement of ocular sympathetic fibers. Then there will be hyperpyrexia due to the severe damage to the pons and the body is cut off from the heat regulating centers in the hypothalamus. Then you have deep coma due to the involvement of reticular formation. Then there will be bilateral paralysis of face and the limbs due to the involvement of facial nerve nuclei and corticospinal fibers. Next we'll see about the tumors of the pons. The astrocytoma of the pons is the most common tumor of the brainstem. It usually occurs in childhood. The signs and symptoms depends on the area affected.